May be seated. It's always an odd thing to come to a funeral like this, and you expect to see, the church full, and there's only a few people here as a family. And yet we know as we gather here, there are many that are joining us, and we want to welcome you to this service. You know, as we, come together to remember the life of Henry DeYoung and to celebrate God's grace through this. And I guess that's a big part of this, is that we come together to celebrate God's grace in the midst of this. And to worship Him. And so I welcome you here this morning as we gather to remember the life of Henry. We gather to share our grief and sorrow in his passing. Our father, grandfather, brother, uncle, friend. Death is such a horrible enemy because we're torn apart from those who we love. Children, Mona and Harvey, Linda and Mike, Arlene and Bart and Charlene and David. Your father, your dad. Yeah, your dad. With someone who loved you, girls, as I think he would refer to you as, the girls. And as you shared stories of your dad with me on Sunday evening, one thing that kept coming through over and over again is his quiet strength and the fact that he always had our back. In fact, he would make decisions based on how it affect the girls, as he would say it. You spoke with great affection towards your father. He was somebody very special to you, and you knew you were special to him. And that's something to really thank God for, to have a dad like that. But your father, your dad, has been taken away. And the last years have been kind of difficult as you see him slowly slipping away. And then with the limited amount of visits that you're able to do over the last while, made it even more difficult. And now he's gone. No more big smiles. Death has separated you from him. And the same your grandkids. I'm told your grandfather loved you and he always had kind of a special place for you, a special way of connecting with you. And I'm sure you too have so many memories. And now he's no longer with us, and I'm sure you'll miss him as well. And brothers and sisters, you come from a big family, 10 siblings. That's quite something. I'm sure there's lots of memories there. I can only imagine the trouble you guys got into and your kids growing up and so much fun together. And one by one, you're saying goodbye to each other. And I'm sure, there are all these memories there, but it's still hard. We have a great hope, and yet it's hard. It's hard. And friends and family together, we feel the sorrow of having lost a father, a grandfather, a brother, a friend, a brother in the Lord. Yet we come together in this time of sorrow to worship God, the God of comfort, and to give him thanks for the life that he gave Henry and for the privilege of having known him and having him a part of our life and in whatever way that we were able to experience him. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives and believing in me will never die." Paul writes, if we live to the Lord. If we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. And Paul writes in Philippians, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." That's a hard concept for us to grasp. To die is gain. And yet we know for Henry, he is free, he is well, he is with our Lord. And so we confess together that our help is in the name of the Lord who made the heavens and the earth and who sent his Son Jesus Christ to redeem all creation, to redeem us as his people. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we come here this morning with heavy hearts. It's hard to say goodbye. Even though we've been saying goodbye for a long time, it's still hard to say goodbye and to let go. So many memories of a life lived. And we come to you, Lord, not only saying goodbye, but as people who are confronting, you know, maybe our own mortality and our own life. And Lord, we come to you during this time and we pray for strength, for hope, for peace. And we pray for the ability to be able to see you in the midst of this, to hear from you. And so we thank you for Henry. We thank you for his faith. Thank you for his life. And we thank you that he was able to point us to you as well. And so we pray that you be with us in this time and bless us and encourage us and hold on to us, especially the family, Lord. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'd like to read Psalm 103, another very comforting scripture passage for us. "Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. the wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and in his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven. His kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Let's respond by singing, "What a friend we have in Jesus." This time we'll have the daughters come forward to share together some of their memories.
Welcome.
Can you pick up the mic?
Welcome to everyone gathered here, as well as those of you watching online. Thank you for participating in the celebration of Dad's life. At this time, we'd like to share some of our memories of our dad and our grandpa. Our dad had a very strong faith in Jesus, his Savior and Lord. His faith carried him through to the end. He lost many things with his disease, but he never lost his faith, and it was a huge comfort to him. Dad enjoyed hearing hymns sung and Bible passages read to him. This past Easter, while in the care home and wearing Easter bunny ears at a party, he told everyone the meaning of Easter and announced, "He is risen." All of Dad's volunteer efforts were faith-based, and he was a charter member of the Trinity CRC. He served on several building committees, as well as on many church councils and Christian school boards. Dad was also a cadet leader and an M2W sponsor. He played in the Abbotsford Christian Marching Band and was a founding member of the Bibles for Missions thrift store in Abbotsford, which occupied a lot of his and Mom's time over the years. Dad enjoyed sports and games. He was in the Farmers Curling League for many years. When we came home from school on Wednesday afternoons, Mom would let us know if his team had won or lost. If his team lost, it could be a very quiet supper. If his team won, he would be in an excellent mood.
Dad excelled at competitive sports such as pickleball and pool. He was very hard to beat. Dad taught us how to play baseball, always playing without a glove himself. Dad played board games and card games to win. He was hard to beat, but also not adverse to a little mild cheating if the occasion demanded. He could always drag at least one of us girls into conspiring to help him win. When it was checkers, we could play all winter before we could beat him at a game. It is still impossible to play Monopoly without thinking about Dad. Dad loved to spend time with his girls, and during our school years, shopping for school clothes was a major event. We would make a trip into Guildford in Surrey and start out by buying him chicken bones at Eaton's. Dad would then wander the mall or snooze in the car, and eventually we would find him sitting on a bench in the mall. Then he'd come into the store where we would get him a chair, and then the parade would begin. We would model our clothes and our choices and justify them to him. Then he would look over things and agree. Dad had a very powerful sweet tooth, and he had very many strategies to satisfy it. He would dip into berries, ice cream, and whipping cream that had been reserved for desserts. He would remove frozen baking from the freezer and thaw the goodies under the couch or anywhere else where they were close at hand. There were many times when Mum would go to serve dessert or baking to guests, only to discover that half of it was missing. I still remember Mom going out and leaving Dad and us together, and Dad turning to me and saying, "It's party time," as he dug into a pail of ice cream. And even with Alzheimer's, he had chocolate stashes located throughout the house, and he could always find them back. Dad refused to drink milk. However, he always enjoyed good stiff pudding, ice cream, yogurt, and buttermilk.
Growing up on the farm, vacations were only a week or so long. Dad and Mom liked to see a lot of country, and it was not a good day for them until they had traveled 500 miles. We'd stop by either a pool or by the lake for the night. Dad would take us fishing early in the mornings. We girls held onto the rod to avoid Dad having to buy a fishing license. But if we got a good bite, he would reel it in. Loon Lake was one of our favorite fishing spots in our adult years. We have fond memories of trolling for hours and hours out in the boat with him. Janessa has fond memories of the summer spent living at Grandma and Grandpa's while working at Wong's. Grandpa faithfully drove her to and from work every day. He also taught her how to drive that summer. Daniel was driving Grandpa's truck at a very young age. He remembers playing ball hockey with Grandpa, and Grandpa enjoyed watching Daniel play hockey, attending many games and many of his tournaments. Chelsea remembers Grandpa picking her and Jeff up from the school bus in his truck. Jeffrey remembers visits to the trout farm. He also remembers playing Mexican train on the patio in the evening and how many times Grandpa would be the first one tapping his tile to say he was only one tile away from winning. Aria remembers playing bocce ball with Grandpa and riding on his antique tractor with him.
As you all know, Dad was very thrifty. Every Christmas, we girls were in tears because he always bought the ugliest and cheapest tree on the lot. He would end up grafting branches into the bare spots to try and keep the peace. This ended as soon as I got my driver's license and we girls took up buying the tree. Dad had many little quirks and traits that we will always remember. He was a real whistler, and he had a special tune that he would whistle in on his way for breakfast to signal Mom that he was coming in. He was a patient and very successful mole hunter. Dad enjoyed catching flies in midair with his bare hand, and he was very good at it. He also excelled in nonverbal communication. He never used a word when a gesture would do. A simple look would tell us what he needed at the dinner table and in many other situations. In family arguments, we girls always stuck up for him over Mom. He was extremely loyal to us, and we to him. In later years, if Mom needed him to agree to something, she would sell it as the girls' idea, and this usually worked. Dad had some very strong ideas about what was suitable for girls on the farm. Although we wanted to do more, he would not teach us certain things or allow us certain jobs. He would say, "That's no job for girls." Although we lost parts of him little by little to Alzheimer's, he was still always our dad. He was always so happy to see us. He would light up when he saw us, and he always knew if there was one of us missing. He was the best dad. And we commented this morning that he's home. And for the last few years, he was always looking for home. And he's home. We love you. We miss you dearly, Dad.
Some of the grandkids going to...
Our family chain. We little knew that morning that God would call your name. In life we loved you dearly, in death we do the same. It broke our hearts to lose you, but you did not go alone. For part of us went with you the day God called you home.
You left us beautiful memories. Your love is still our guide. And though we cannot see you, you are always by our side. Our family chain is broken, and nothing seems the same. But as God calls us one by one, the chain will link again.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Sing hallelujah. Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Oh,
How does one capture a life? And many memories, pictures, so many things as we reflect on, just kind of going back through time. Let's pray. Father, we come to you and, you know, just remembering this life that you have given. And we thank you that we may know that this life is not finished, is not swallowed up in death, but that Henry lives with you. And we pray, Lord, that you will continue to give us hope and peace and strength and fill that void that is within our lives, that we too may look forward to that great reunion together. So be with us, comfort us. Thank you again for the many memories. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So we're going to respond by singing "How Great Thou Art." This time I'd like to read Psalm 23, a psalm that the family's chosen for me to focus on this morning. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, or through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Mona, Linda, Arlene, Charlene, when I asked you for a scripture passage, you chose this scripture passage, Psalm 23, a very familiar passage. And the reason that you chose this passage is that you said you read it often to your dad over the last number of months in your visits, whether that be in person or via Skype. And I find it telling that your dad would engage when you read scripture passages, familiar passages, especially like this one, and he would fully engage and be focused on that. And yet when you talked about some of the current events, he had a difficult time staying engaged. It is telling because it shows something that was in his heart. Yeah. He had a love for God, a quiet faith, a strong faith that was displayed, as you mentioned, even in the care home. I just love that story about the Easter, dressing up an Easter bunny and stuff. And no, this isn't the real story. He is risen. Yeah. He knew that. And as he struggled to remember many things, he still knew the gospel, the good news. Jesus is alive. I remember when I came here, said to me a couple of times, and even had it conveyed to me a couple of times that, you know, to remember to preach the gospel. You know, that was at his heart. He had this real concern. It was of utmost importance to him. He wasn't your in-your-face kind of evangelist in any way. And yet he showed his faith in this quiet strength. You know, one of the things I often wonder and try to think, when, especially at funerals and so on, is what does a person's life tell me about God? How did they demonstrate that? What are qualities in their life points us to God? And we see that Henry knew God's care for him, and that seemed to be displayed in so much of what he lived. This is a loved psalm that you have chosen, and it's a very familiar, because it shows us a gentle, compassionate, caring God who loves us and holds on to us. And it begins with the theme that is kind of the statement for the whole thing, that the Lord, the covenant God, Yahweh, the one who said, I will be there for you no matter what, this covenant God is our shepherd, our provider, the one who takes care of us, so much so that we will lack nothing. One of the things that has been mentioned already is that your dad was someone that, for you girls, always had your back. He was always there for you. He wanted to make sure you said that you succeeded. You know, that was important to him. That points us to our God, who takes care of us. You know, providing green pastures, quiet waters. Usually when I have an image of that, I feel always have lush green pastures and so on. I was in the Middle East a few years ago, and the tour guide talked about green pastures, and there were little spots of grass here and there, but it was a big deal for the shepherd to find some grass, some herbs, little bushes with green on it for the sheep to eat. It's very sparse. And to find quiet waters is important because it's incredibly dry there. And to find a little pool of quiet waters is huge. The good shepherd, in the midst of this barren landscape, provides and takes care of his sheep and gets them food and so that they're not in want, refreshing our soul, giving us that sense of shalom, of peace, knowing we are held. And he leads us along the right path. God shows us the way to himself. I'm sure you remember many things that your dad taught you as well as you grew up. Life lessons. Things that you do so often, you go back, yeah, dad taught me that. Dad showed me that. And maybe those even become more evident in the weeks and months to come. He taught you faith. Faithfulness. It's probably very much at the very center of so much of what he taught. Even through difficult times. As a child, I am sure he was there. Not too many words. But as I listened to you share your stories, it was very comforting to know that he cared. And he didn't have to use a lot of words. All of this, as a good parent, points us to our Heavenly Father, the true shepherd, and his Son Jesus, who came and said, "I am the good shepherd. I lay down my life for my sheep. I provide for them so they will have life." You know, as a parent, we raise our children to be mature and to set them on their way, and the goal is always that they will leave home. At least that's the goal. It doesn't always happen, but what the goal is that they will leave home and that they will be on their own. But with our Father in heaven, the goal is to bring us home. Bring us into relationship with him. That's why he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, to conquer death. And Jesus, as the good shepherd, promised us that he was going to prepare a place for us. And when he'd prepared a place for us, he would bring us home to be with him. Last Wednesday, the Lord came and took Henry home. Yeah, it's a powerful statement that you said. You know, he's been looking for home for the last while. God took him home to dwell with him forever. Henry lived a blessed life. Not because, you know, he came from an amazing family with these awesome siblings and so on. And not because he had a good marriage and wife, not because he was successful and had four wonderful daughters and some pretty stellar grandsons too, son-in-laws, and some amazing grandkids as well, and friends. He had a blessed life because he knew the Lord. You know, surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. To live with the Lord, to be in his presence. His cup overflowed as a result of that. And there's that sense of peace, of I'm knowing the Lord. And that's what the psalm is really about, is just that sense of care and of living in the presence of God. And that blessing follows us all the days of our lives, that we have that sense of living with God and his presence all the days of our life. There's a taste of being home there, of that shalom and that peace. But we wait in anticipation of going home. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Forever. Henry's home. He is home. What a gift that is. He's been on that journey for a long time, and now he's home. And if there's one thing his desire was, is that we would know the way home too through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that we would join him someday to be home. You know, when we remember a life and we look at all these pictures and memories and so many things and we celebrate that and that's all good. And there's so much to give thanks to God for in the midst of it. But the real blessing is knowing that even though this life is passing away, we are held by our Father in heaven, the Father that Henry wanted to point you to throughout his whole life, this Father who sent his Son to take us home. And that's our hope. That's our peace. That's our comfort. That's our gift of shalom. Our cup overflows. Let's pray. Father, we again thank you for the life of Henry. We thank you for the gospel that he lived, that he was a man of faith who knew you as his heavenly Father. And who tried in many ways to point us to you. And we know things weren't always perfect and there were moments and we're not perfect, Lord. But we see your grace shining through in his life and we thank you for that. And we pray, Lord, that as we continue on too, that we too may be able to build our lives on that foundation of being able to share that faith as well and to live it. And we pray too, Lord, that as you've taken Henry home, that one day too, you'll take us home to be with you forever. Hold on to us, guide us, comfort us, encourage us, we pray. In the name of Jesus, amen. We're going to respond to that with a beautiful song, When Peace Like a River. We'll stand again to sing this. Following the service, we will depart out of here and go to Hazelwood Cemetery. Let me extend to you God's blessing before we go. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. And we all say, Amen.